think of the person we are, not necessarily what we're about to do next, but our broad tendencies. Oh, yes, happy and lucky person, some aspects of our personality may be added to the brain structure. And that's important because many of us in our lives will have brain scans. And if the possibility emerges that one might be able to extract such collateral information from a scan collected from another perspective, that raises important aspects of privacy and important aspects of consent and other ethical issues.
And also, if we were able to build a decoder that was able to decode our thoughts, then surely the reverse would also be true. Surely an individual could then impose thoughts on our mind.
I think that's an exaggeration. I think there are technical barriers to a thought encoder that you're talking about. Chief amongst them is we simply do not have any non-invasive technique. And it's a technique that doesn't involve opening up the brain or putting electrodes in the brain or things like that that we probably only do in patients with disorders such as epilepsy and treat. We don't have any technique for manipulating brain activity on that kind of scale. So things like internal social networks mind, where a device is able to mirror memories and remain firmly around the size social media.
Being able to communicate with people who are in a permanent vegetative state allows us to improve the way we care for them, making us more responsive to their needs. But perhaps the greatest question, which is never put to the patient, is whether they wish to continue living in that locked-in state. Should we ask?
I do think so. I think we have to get to the point where we can be certain of their competence to make certain kinds of decisions, and so we have to understand more about what their level of consciousness is and what their cognitive abilities are. But if we determine that they are competent to make those decisions, I think that they should be given a say, and perhaps it'll take an extended conversation and discussion with loved ones and all sorts of other things. At least if it were me, I would want someone to ask me what I thought about continuing to, remain in a state that doesn't hold a lot of hope for recovery in any normal sense. So, I think that people could really fall on different sides of a line of wanting to remain conscious but unable to interact with people in normal ways and unable to move, versus really thinking that this is the end of the line and they'd like to go with dignity. So, I think that there is a moral imperative to get to the point where we can give them a say in those kinds of decisions.
Ethics aside, the technology for reading minds is still in its infancy. fMRI is useful, but has several limitations, not least the huge lie-down machine required. Implanting electrodes in the brain boosts the signal and reliability of the reading, but this kind of risky surgery is only going to be supported if there is a strong medical reason for it. The research is continuing. Back in the lab in Birmingham University, Damien Cruz showed me his way of trying to communicate with people with PBS. He's using an old technology, EEG.
It's more fMRI than it is, isn't it?
No.
Some of the electrodes here, this boundary of 52 origin, and they have a little piece of silver right there, and they have a little preamplifier surrounding them here. They record the signal and send it down the silver into the amplifier, which is
here. So they're basically drawing things on a line.
Exactly, and we'll plug them into the swimming
space. So
like a cosmonaut.
Indeed. And so the patient would have to have that on for, an hour?
Yeah.
And during that time, it's able to just read the signals produced by the brain parts that are right next to the skull.
Yes, that's the tricky thing with EEG, is that the electrical signals that your brain is producing are very, very small, so we measure those in microvolts. Whereas electrical signals in your own all the time being produced by computers. Your muscles produce electrical signals all the time, and those are much bigger because they're closer to the electrodes than your brain. And so we need to do some very careful processing of the data to separate what is coming from your brain and what is
Have you tried this on any patients yet?
We have, but with no luck
so far. If we wanted to have a communication device that patients could use, we need something that they can use at their bedside and which is cheap. And magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, just isn't the answer to that. And so we need things like EEG to allow patients to communicate. However, it comes with its own set of issues. The EEG system is very noisy, so it's very difficult to identify the particular pattern that we're interested in from that. And we're also still working on the types of questions that we ask people to think about. So when we started, we were asking people to imagine using their hand and imagine using their chest. This is basically for historical reasons, in that there are several decades of research in how that should look in EEG. And it's actually very helpful to base these tasks on what we know.
So these give very different signals today. Moving your hand looks very different on the EEG screen and moving your feet.
Well, so this is the thing. Across a group of healthy individuals, they look really very different. However, in your eye, in any given one person, separating them is much harder. And this is simply because the EEG signal is very noisy.
And so some work we've been doing recently is looking at tailoring the thing that I ask you to think about to you. So we've done some work with pianists. We asked pianists to imagine moving a hand, like we would with a regular approach. But we also asked them to imagine playing a simple piece of piano music and a complex piece of piano music. And we find that we double our chances of detecting what you're thinking about if I ask you to. If you're a pianist, if I ask you to imagine playing a complicated piece of piano music. So perhaps what we need to be thinking about is tailoring our tasks to the specific patient's abilities before they have their injury.
We are still a long way from being able to read people's thoughts in any complexity. Perhaps that will never be possible. But for the patients who are unable to speak, who are locked inside their own heads because of illness or injury, the possibility of communicating directly from the brain to another person or device would be life-changing. Some researchers think they are tantalizingly close. I'm Miller.